My name is Liz Rampe, and I'm a planetary geologist at the NASA Johnson Space Center. I'm also the deputy PI of one of the instruments on the Curiosity rover. It's called the Kenman instrument. It's an X-ray diffractometer, so it tells us about the minerals that we find in the rock and the soil samples. So I'm more of a mineralogist, but it's really the sedimentology that is truly stunning in Gale Crater. So today I'm going to show you a lot of images of sedimentary rocks so you get an idea of what the depositional environments were like in Gale Crater 3.5 billion years ago. I'll also show you some evidence for diagenesis. We'll tie in a little bit of the mineralogy so you get a more complete picture of what early Mars was like. Next slide, please. So Curiosity landed in Gale Crater in August 2012, so we've been there almost 5.5 years now. Gale Crater is an impact basin. It's about 150 kilometers in diameter, and in the middle is a mound of layered sedimentary rock called Mount Sharp. It's about 5 kilometers tall. And we landed in Gale Crater because, based on orbital spectral observations, we see a variation in mineralogy in the lowest layers of Mount Sharp, where we see the lowest layers have a lot of phyllosilicates, and layers just above it, or just younger than that, have a lot of sulfate salts. So this suggests that there was once an environment that was much wetter, that transitioned to one that was more saline, more evaporative. And this suggests that there was a dramatic climate change on Mars about 3.5 billion years ago. So by studying these units with Curiosity, we can characterize these ancient environments and try to determine whether they would have been habitable to ancient microbial life, at least by our standards of habitability on Earth. Next slide. So we've driven through a little over 400 meters of stratigraphy over the last 5 years or so, and this strat column shows you just the lower half of that stratigraphy. This up here shows you our traverse from our landing site on the plains down to where we are today. And actually, I had to turn to my slides about a month ago, so we're actually a few hundred meters south and east of here up on this ridge. We've driven a little, almost 18 kilometers, and this shows you all of our major waypoints. We've encountered all sorts of sedimentary rocks on our traverse, fluvial, aeolian, lacustrine, and deltaic. And just to show you some of the more important outcrops that we've encountered, down here is the Link conglomerate. We saw it very close to our landing site because the descent rockets blew off a lot of the surface dust and sediment. And based on the size of these rounded pebbles, we think it was deposited in a river that was up to a meter deep. Then further along on our traverse, we got to the Kimberley, and we did an extensive campaign here. At the Kimberley, we see these sandstone beds that are gently dipping towards the center of the crater. And then when we got to the base of Mount Sharp, that's when we first saw what we call the Murray Formation. The Murray Formation is hundreds of meters thick. And in some intervals, we see laminated mudstone, suggesting deposition in a lake environment. There are also intervals that show some cross stratification, suggesting deposition in fluvial and aeolian environments. And then more recently, we were in this sort of hodgepodge of fluvial, aeolian, and lacustrine deposits that we call the heterolithic part of the Murray Formation. We also see the Stimson Formation is an aeolian sandstone that unconformably overlies the Murray Formation, and it just forms these gorgeous buttes. So what I'm going to do is take you along this traverse, show you some more of these rocks, and come up with a depositional model to explain our observations. Next slide. Great. So very early on in the campaign, we stopped at the Yellowknife Bay. It's predominantly made up of this fractured mudstone, and we see a lot of evidence for diagenesis here. These raised ridges are enriched in magnesium, suggesting there was magnesium-rich groundwaters moving through here. We also see these little spherules down here, down there, suggesting there was water percolating through pores in the sediments before they were lithified. Next slide. Okay, we finally got to our target, which was the lower slopes of Mount Sharp in September 2014 at the Pahrump Hills outcrop. And just for scale, this is about 12 meters of section. This yellow line shows you our traverse through this section. We did this 3 times and spent 5 months here. These dots represent stops along our traverse where we took images and geochemical and mineralogical measurements. And most of the Pahrump Hills, we see laminated mudstone. You can see some of the laminations here. They vary from millimeter scale to sub-centimeter scale. But we also see a lot of diagenesis here, too, or evidence for it. We see dendritic crystal clusters and veins and concretions. But here, this is the Mojave 2 target. It's been brushed from its surface dust. And you can see these millimeter scale lenticular crystal molds. They're reminiscent of gypsum. We don't actually find gypsum here, so we think it's since been replaced, but this is good evidence for early diagenesis. Next slide. Further down the road, we stopped at Mariahs Pass, and we stopped here because we saw the highest abundance of SiO2 or silica on the mission to date, where some of these targets had over 90 weight percent SiO2. And here at Mariahs Pass, we also see a contact between the Murray mudstone and the overlying Simpson sandstone. Along this contact and just above and below, we see bleached fractures, suggesting that there were leaching fluids moving through here during late diagenesis. Next slide. And just to show you some more recent images from the heterolithic part of the Murray Formation, we see a lot of evidence for diagenesis here. So on the left is an outcrop where you see these horizontal laminations, but also some centimeter scale concretions peppered throughout. On the right is a different outcrop. It's a fractured mudstone. You can see the majority of it is red. But if you look closely along these fractures, you'll notice that it's a gray color, maybe suggesting that there were reducing fluids moving through here after the rock was lithified. Next slide. And this image just shows you how different this part of the Murray Formation is from those laminated mudstones that we saw. So in this exposed face, you can see cross stratification. This might be trough cross stratification from the migration of ripples across the surface in a fluvial or aeolian environment. Again, 3.5 billion years ago on Mars. Next slide. We also see evidence for desiccation and evaporation in this interval. On the left is a target that we called Old Soaker. For scale, this is about a meter across. And on the surface, you can see fossilized mud cracks from the subaerial desiccation of muds, again, 3.5 billion years ago on Mars. On the right is a different outcrop, and you can see these bright bedding parallel bands. Those are sulfate salts from the evaporation of these lake waters and the precipitation of salts. Next slide. Okay, so taking all of these images into account, we can come up with a depositional model to explain them. We saw those conglomerates and dipping sandstones on the plains. We saw those laminated mudstones in the Murray Formation, cross stratification in the Murray. We saw evidence for desiccation and for diagenesis. So if you were in Gale Crater 3.5 billion years ago on Mars, looking up at the rim, you would have seen streams and rivers emanating from it. Probably from snowmelt, but these streams and rivers would have deposited those conglomerates on the plains. Where they flowed into lakes on the crater floor, there would have been delta deposits, and those gently dipping sandstone beds of the Kimberley represent a prograding delta deposit. Then those laminated mudstones would have been deposited in the lake. Along the lake margin, there would have been evaporation and desiccation, forming those mud cracks and those salts. And then there would have been groundwaters moving through here, probably not only when the rivers and lakes were present, but long afterwards to form those diagenetic features. And so this red line represents Curiosity's Traverse, where we started off in these fluvial deposits, but more recently, we've been sort of skirting this lake margin, sampling both fluvial and lacustrine deposits. Next slide. So we can also use the mineralogy to build a more complete picture of what these environments were like. These pie diagrams show you the mineral abundances For all the fluvial lacustrine rocks that we've drilled to date along our traverse up Mount Sharp. And I'll point out just a few of the mineral groups. In black is magnetite, red is hematite. So you see that the lower samples have a lot more magnetite, upper samples have a lot more hematite, suggesting probably more oxic conditions up here. And in yellow is calcium sulfate salts. So again, these upper samples are younger samples, probably experienced more evaporative conditions. And the combination of both a lot of hematite and calcium sulfate in these younger samples, again, suggests evaporative and oxic conditions, and this might be a marker of climate change on early Mars. Next slide. Okay, so I'm going to end with just where we are today. We are up on the Vera Rubin Ridge, next slide. We stopped here because we saw evidence for hematite from orbit, and these red pixels just show you where the CRISM orbiting spectrometer has identified hematite. The goal is to traverse a little ways along this ridge, look at depositional environments, try to compare it to the underlying Murray formation, and also to figure out how this hematite formed. Was it detrital? What did it precipitate in lake waters, or is it a diagenetic process? Next slide. So I'll just show you a few images of the ridge itself. These are some mosaics. As we start to climb the lower part of the ridge, you'll see some horizontal laminations with the occasional crossbed, pretty similar to what we saw in the Murray Formation. Next slide. This is an image as we start climbing up the lower ridge. You can see the lower slopes of Mount Sharp in the distance. Next slide. This is just picture time now. Here's an outcrop from the middle part of the ridge, and you can see a lot of bedding planes from which we can estimate strikes and dips, just like a real terrestrial geologist. Next slide. And this is a mosaic of the upper part of the ridge, but if we stretch the colors a little bit, next slide, you can see that there are all sorts of variations. There's bright and dark spots, there's purples, blues, grays, all suggesting a lot of compositional variation here on the Vera Rubin Ridge. Next slide. I'm just going to end with this mosaic from the upper part of the ridge. Again, in the foreground, this is the ridge, and you can see all those beautiful color variations. But in the background, you can see more units up on Mount Sharp that we hope to visit in the next year or two. So if you're interested in the latest from Curiosity, especially from the Vera Rubin Ridge, there's an oral session tomorrow afternoon, and Abby Freeman will be presenting the latest results from Vera Rubin Ridge. Thanks.